There are so many ways you can rate limit your system, and there are so many reasons you need rate limiting for your system. In this video, I'm going to talk about multiple approaches using which you can rate limit your system. And then I'm also going to talk about the Java implementation of the same thing which you can use in your project. I know many of you don't really use the Java implementation of the rate limiter, but it is definitely good to understand. But before that, what I'm going to do is to give you the overall picture and the overall options you have to rate limit your system. So there are two ways you can rate limit your system. And before that, there are multiple reasons you need to rate limit. You want to save yourself from the DDoS attack. You want to save your system from one bad client which could consume all your resources. So there are many reasons you need to rate limit, and there are many ways you could rate limit. So the first thing is, you can use a ready-made solution. Why should I care to rate limit myself when there are lots of ready-made solutions? Wherever you host your service, those services provide rate limiter. If you have, let's say, Amazon AWS, then they provide a rate limiter for their own services. Likewise for Google. So we have Google Cloud API gateways. We have Amazon API gateways. Likewise, Azure also provides the API gateway, which does the rate limiter. And there are other options as well, like Azure Front Door, which again does the rate limiting. Now, apart from that, there are multiple tools which you use, like Nginx and Apache. They also have the rate limiting solutions. So you just set up those services in front of your service. You make a bunch of configurations and you are good. And that's how most of the people get their jobs done. Now, the thing is that at times you would not want to do that, or you might want to understand what happens internally. So there are multiple libraries in Java which do the rate limiting. So for example, there is a Guava rate limiter. There is Bucket4j, and that is very common Bucket4j library which a lot of people use. So I'm going to dig a little bit on this library, and I'll show you how the rate limiting overall works for this one. Then there is a Redison library, there is a Rateback library, Drop Wizard library. There are multiple libraries. But what I'm going to do today is to dig deeper into the Bucket4j library. So once you do that, you will see the overall flow. So before moving into the Bucket4j library, what I'll do is that I'll talk a bit about what is the token bucket algorithm which Bucket4j uses. I have made one separate video on the details of this Bucket4j. So what I have done, not Bucket4j, but the token bucket algorithm, that how things work at the low level, and I'll link the description somewhere here. You can check that code. It's a very simple code, I think 10-15 lines of code, and it does the same job of token bucket. So coming to the token bucket, imagine that you have a bucket, and that bucket is getting filled at a fixed rate. Let's say you have set up that my API has 60 requests per second. So that bucket will be filled with 60 tokens per second. And then whenever a new request comes, whenever a new API comes, you take one token from the bucket. And you can take the token from the bucket only if the token is available. If it's not available, then you cannot take it. So when the token is available, you give the success response or you proceed further. And when the token is not available, you can give request denied or 429, whatever you want to the caller, that, hey, you don't have enough quota for this particular minute or hour or whatever you have configured. So that's the overall idea of Bucket4j. Now this Bucket4j library, which is there, it does exactly the same thing. It implements token bucket algorithm. And when you go to their documentation, they say that they do much beyond token bucket. So it's good for you to go to their website and check what all other things they do. But they definitely easily implement the Bucket4j algorithm. Now, you have a backend service. A lot of requests are coming to your backend services, and you want to rate limit it. But your backend services can be multiple as well, right? Backend service 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. There can be many backend services, right? So And you want to rate limit overall, that it should not happen that a bad customer is hitting different backend services and then choking different services. You want to have overall quota. So this Bucket4j library provides a way to use a common storage so that you can have a common storage for all the requests coming to your server. So they support external storage for the distributed backends, where you have multiple backends. So you have to store the quota somewhere in the common place. So they have around 9 data sources like Amazon DynamoDB, Postgres, Oracle, all the common storage system, which you can use for your rate limiting system. And that's what they do. So now what I'll do is I'll quickly move on to the coding part and show you how things happen. And it will be a brief intro to the coding overall. So this is the code which I have already written. Now, if you see in my pom.xml, what I have done is that I have imported only one dependency. So this is, there are 3 dependencies, but the first one is the basic one. The second two I'm using for the distributed case. So let's say you just want to have in-memory rate limiter. You import the first dependency. And then what you do is that you use that library. You use that library in this way, that you import the code. And then here you can define various rate limiters. So I have defined that every minute I would refill 10 tokens. And I have the capacity of 10 in my bucket. And I can, in fact, define multiple buckets. So what will happen is that whenever a request comes, it needs to pass through multiple conditions and then it should run. So that's what I have done here, that in-memory bucket, you can configure in this way. And this is just a test code that if you try to consume beyond a certain time, beyond a certain number of token, it will start to give you the deny response. That's, this one will give you false. Likewise, for the distributed rate limiter, what you have to do is to give the Redis endpoint. So I have run Redis on my local host with 6379 port. And then what I do is the same thing, that you configure the bucket and then you run the code. And when you run the code, it gives you true or false. So whenever a request comes to your controller, the first thing you can do is to call this method bucket.tryConsume. If it gives you true, then you proceed further and do the rest of the things in your controller. And if it gives you false, then you return from there itself. So that's the idea. I mean, you can even make it more sophisticated by having interceptor or whatnot, but that's the overall idea. So I have already run the Redis one on my local. I have run. So what I'll do is that I'll just run this code. So the way you run the Redis is pretty straightforward. You can run Redis on your Mac or Windows, whatever. I'm not going to get into the details of that. So I have run Redis on my machine. What I'll do is that I'll just run this code here and let's see the output, how things look like. So you see, it gives me true. So basically it will give me true for first 5 seconds and first 5 calls, and then it will start giving me false. So I have configured the bucket in this way. I don't want to get into the details of, how these buckets are configured. But if you want, I would definitely love to have a detailed video on the coding and the details. But if you just focus on these lines, you will figure out that how the buckets are being filled. So this is the initial capacity of the bucket. And then this is the refill interval, that, fill the bucket with 10 tokens every minute, fill the bucket with 5 tokens every 20 seconds. So likewise, you can configure things and things will just work fine for you. So yeah, that's the overall idea for this particular video. What I have done is I have uploaded this code. So you can check out this code in the GitHub. And once you check out, you will realize more. I recommend you that you clone this repo and then see. I also recommend you to see the public documentation of their repository. So I have already put up the link here. So they have the public documentation of Bucket4j. You can check out as that as well. And if you don't want to have any library, then I have made one different project and you can check out that as well. So that's it from my side for this video. Till the next time, bye.